Hello everyone, welcome back for the second part of lesson 3 of the basics of deep learning. So in this lesson we'll speak mostly about optimization for deep learning, and it follows of course part 1 of lesson 3 where we saw which loss to use for classification or regression. So we'll first speak shortly about optimization of deep learning. So I will do a recap on gradient descent, stochastic gradient descent, and mini-batch stochastic gradient descent. This will be short. Then the second part will be the longest one. I will describe several different gradient descent algorithms, and you will need to code them during the lesson. And the last part will be quite short and present the PyTorch optimizers. So let's start with optimization for deep learning. So as we just saw in the previous video, the objective of an optimization algorithm is to reduce the training error. But indeed, what we care about is more the generalization error, or what we call the validation error in the previous notebooks. In order to reduce the generalization error, you need to be careful and pay attention to overfitting. So this is what I described in length in my previous video. But for this part of the lesson, we will forget about overfitting. And we will try to reduce the training error as much as possible. So we mostly concentrate on the performance of the optimization algorithm. We keep in mind that this is not exactly what we'd like to do in the end, but we will see in the future lessons how to deal with the overfitting phenomena that might occur because of the training error being too low. So this is not a theoretical mathematical course on optimization. So you will see no theorem here. I will only present algorithm and try to give some intuition about why it works. Okay, so what do we optimize? A cost function. So remember, this is a standard cost function for linear regression, which is basically a quadratic loss, mean square error. If you are dealing with a deep neural network, instead of having something which is linear here, you have something which is not linear here. And also the quadratic loss is convex. Now this function, as a function of the parameter theta, is highly non-convex. So you cannot use the mathematical theory of convex optimization in order to get results in deep learning. Nevertheless, we hope that the gradient descent algorithm that have been developed and shown to work well in a convex setting will still be able to do a good job in deep learning. So what are the three gradient descent algorithms we saw so far? They all depend on the learning rate eta, which gives you the size of the steps you want to make in the opposite direction of the gradient because you want to minimize. So the first one we saw is a batch gradient descent where you have access to the full gradient of your loss function, but this is very costly to compute. You need to see all your data set in order to be able to compute this. So another version is the stochastic gradient descent where you make an update on your parameter each time you see a new point of your dataset. So this is the gradient of the loss function associated to the sample, the highest sample in your dataset. So this term is basically the sum over all the i's of these terms. And there is an intermediate between this batch gradient descent and stochastic gradient descent, which is called mini-batch gradient descent, where instead of updating the parameter each time you see a new sample, you take a batch, So here I'm taking a Python way of writing what is a batch. So this is a batch of B sample with their labels. And you compute the gradient associated to this batch, so the sum of the individual gradient here over the sample inside the batch, and you make one update of your parameter each time you see a new batch. So this is by far the most common algorithm which is used in deep learning these days. So what are the challenges of mini-batch gradient descent? Well, first, it's not always easy to find the proper learning rate. It's not clear at all that the learning rate should be fixed. Remember, even for a convex function, you'd like the learning rate to decrease when you are reaching your optimum. It's not at all clear that you want to apply the same learning rate to all the parameters. You are in a high dimensional space, and perhaps the gradient is much steeper in one direction than in another, so you will go much faster in this direction, so perhaps you should not go at the same speed in all directions. Another point which is quite intriguing is it's hard for a gradient descent algorithm to escape saddle points like this, because at the red point here, you see that all the gradients are close to zero. So meaning that the gradient is completely uninformative about which direction to take. So it's not completely obvious how to escape these saddle points in high dimension. So this is the main purpose of this lecture, to introduce modification of stochastic gradient descent and see what are the intuition behind these modifications. So for simplicity here, I will work on a mini-batch gradient, but I will take the very simple notation where I'm removing the explicit dependence into the batch. So for today, it will be fine, but remember that each time I'm writing this, indeed, this is an update done on one batch and not on the whole gradient in practice. Okay, so for today, you will need now to work a little bit and run this Jupyter notebook simultaneously. Okay. So on this Jupyter notebook, I coded a simple function to optimize this function of two variables. And you will need to code the various algorithms that are presented in this lesson. As we see them. Okay. So here I did the code for gradient descent. So this is just to show the plot. This train2D function is taking as argument a trainer, and a trainer will just compute what are the next position for the parameter. So here I'm optimizing this function f of x1 and x2. So I need to compute each time I'm making an update of my following my gradient, I need to compute the new position of x1 and x2. This is what the trainer will do. So this is what you will need to program. And once this is done, you can use the showTrace2D to see what is the effect of your algorithm on the gradient descent. So here, this is a 2D function, okay, in x1 and x2. Here, I just computed the gradient of this function. Those are two variables. So the gradient algorithm will update x1 following the gradient according to x1. In this case, derivating this with respect to x1, you obtain 0.2 times x1. And you update the value of x2 by minus eta, the learning rate, times 4 times x2, which is the derivative of this function with respect to x2. And you see here that you obtain a path like this, which shows you the different steps of the gradient descent for this particular function. Okay, so the showTrace2D is taking as input this function, you will not modify it, and the train2D of the trainer that you will need to modify here. So here you see that it converges nicely to the global optima. So the function f is a kind of deep valley in what direction. And you see that you start to see trouble, for example, if you take eta a little bit bigger. So here I took eta equal to 0.4. With eta equal to 0.6, you see that the gradient descent algorithm is oscillating a lot, and indeed it's not converging. Okay, you start here and you end up at very large value of the function. That's because you are taking a step which is too big compared to the depth of the valley. So you jump from one side to the other and you end up increasing your value. So this is bad behavior of stochastic gradient descent when you are not choosing properly the learning rate. Okay. So the first modification to the vanilla SGD is called momentum, and it tried to go faster than HGD. You see here that even when I'm converging, I'm starting with big oscillation. This is due to the fact that the gradient is much bigger in one direction than in the other. So, for example, the first move I'm going from the starting point here to here. The second one, I'm going mostly in the opposite direction and progressing a little bit towards the minima. So what I could do is when I'm here, I can remember that I'm going from this direction, and instead of going straight away in the opposite direction, I will remember this position and mitigate this new update of my gradient. So this is what we call momentum, where you are dampening the oscillation by averaging the last value of your gradient. So mathematically, you can write it like that. So instead of updating according to your gradient, you update your parameter theta with respect to v, with a new quantity v t plus 1, which is your gradient at time t, plus a parameter where you gamma times your previous step. Okay. So why is it working? If you expand a little bit this, you see that actually the next step you are doing, Vt plus 1, is basically, if you express it in terms of all the gradient you have seen so far, it's a weighted average of your gradient, of the last gradient, with a parameter gamma to the power I. So gamma is less than 1, typically. So this gamma of I is decreasing to 0. And so what you see is that when k is large, this gamma times k is very small, so you forget the initial value of v of t. And vt plus 1 is just basically the sum, a weighted sum, of your previous last gradient with a window which is given by the parameter gamma. Okay. So instead of oscillating like that, you will sum these different gradients and have a much smoother curve. So this is what is written, what you see here. So the momentum, you should obtain something like that. And now, what I'm asking you is to pause the video right now and try to insert your code here for the momentum following to code this algorithm. So this is a mathematical expression, and you need to code it in Python in the Jupyter notebook. Okay, so now let's go to a second amelioration of the gradient descent, which is due to Nesterov. So this is called Nesterov accelerated gradient. And the idea here is taken from a slide from Jeff Hinton's Coursera course. It's that with the momentum, what you do is you first compute the gradient where you are, and you make a small step, and then you make a following step which corresponds to the momentum. So in blue here, you are following the gradient, and then following the momentum, which is basically the sum of the previous gradient you observed so far. So what Nesterov proposes is to do basically the opposite, to first move from here following the momentum, and then make an update from where you landed according to the gradient, which is computed not anymore at the origin, but at the end of this point, so in red here, and you obtain this green arrow. Next step, you first follow your momentum, and then do an update according to the local gradient. So in mathematical terms, this means that the update now Vt plus 1 is given by this slight modification. You follow, this is the momentum part, and this is the gradient, but computed at the translated point, translated with the momentum. So again, here, I'm asking you to pause the video. And to code the Nesterov accelerated gradient in this cell. And I'm putting again the mathematical code for the algorithm. Okay. So next we'll speak about AdaGrad. So here the motivation for AdaGrad is to try to update each individual parameter of the theta with its own learning rate, if you want. So this is why now I'm not updating the full vector theta. I'm updating the theta t of I, which is the highest component of my parameter theta. And I'm doing this in the following way. I'm following basically the gradient, the direction of the gradient in the highest direction corresponding to highest parameter with a learning rate eta. But now I'm rescaling this with this S function. And this S function is basically the sum of all the square of the gradient. So the S function is increasing. And the intuition is the more you made update in the highest direction, the bigger S will be, and so the lower the learning rate should be, because you should probably be close to a local, to an optima, and you should decrease the parameter eta for this particular direction. So this allows you to do the tuning of the learning parameter automatically, just with this scaling function. So again, you can stop the video now and code the AdaGrad version on the Jupyter notebook over there and obtain this simulation. So here are three equations. Next algorithm, it's called RMS prop, and it fixes one problem of Adagrad. The problem of Adagrad is the parameter s of t is always increasing. So the learning rate will go to zero, and you can be stuck because this becomes too small. So an idea proposed by Jeff Hinton in his Coursera class, actually the same as we saw before, is to modify this scaling function and to take an exponential average, so that this s of t is basically only the sum of the last gradient seen so far, where gamma tunes the interval on which you are summing the gradient. So this is not exactly summing the gradient, this is a window which is decreasing with gamma. But you see that this s t plus 1 will not go to infinity, so that the learning rate here will remain positive. Okay, so this is a slight modification of the Adagrad, which fixes the problem of learning rate going to zero. And here I'm rewriting the same equation as here, but in a matrix form. So again, your task now is to pause the video and to code the RMS prop algorithm over there to obtain a picture like that. And come back to the video once you are done. Okay, we have seen momentum and we have seen adapting the learning rate for the parameter. So the next natural idea is to try to mix the idea from RMS prop and momentum. And this is exactly what people did when they derived the ADAM algorithm. So you see there are basically two internal states in your optimizer. The M here is a weighted average of your previous M and the current gradient. The V is a scaling. So this is M is for the momentum. The V is a scaling you want to do a la RMS prop. So this is, you are summing the square of the gradient here. And then you are making an update according to the new momentum rescaled with the V of t. So you are not exactly, you see that here there is a M hat and a V hat. So you are not exactly using this MT plus 1 and VT plus 1. And the reason explained in the paper is that since you start with initial value 0 here for M0 and V0, you have a bias when you are computing this MT plus 1 and VT plus 1 because of this term from the past. So you have a bias towards 0. In order to remove this, you divide that by this factor 1 minus beta. So this bias is very high if the beta 1 and beta 2 are close to 1, which are the default value taken in practice. So this 1 minus beta 1 to the power t plus 1 is here to cancel this factor of bias. So again, it's time to stop the video and for you to code the ADAM algorithm over there. Obtain a picture like that. Now, one last adaptation of ADAM is called IMS grad, where you will change only one thing, namely instead of rescaling it, you will forget this. And the other thing that, sorry, you will change two things, so there is no rescaling of the MT and VT. And now, what the author observed with Adam is that it can forget two past, in the sense that you might have batches which are very informative, the gradient is big, but because you are smoothing it with this function on rescaling it with the V, you don't see they have no impact. So Adam will get kind of trapped in local minima. And to avoid this, they propose to modify slightly the way you scale the parameter eta with a max here instead of taking the VT plus one. So that if your VT plus one is very big, then you take it, but otherwise you keep the previous one. So again, you can code it here on the Jupyter notebook. And if you are interested, since this is the last example, we can have a look at the paper who proposed it. It's this one. And well, okay, it's directly open at the IMSGrad algorithm. And you see that here, well, this corresponds exactly to this equation over there. Okay, so now that you have coded all these various versions of the optimizer, you will not need to do it anymore because this has been done for you in PyTorch, in the Torch Optim package. The documentation is here, and you see that you have many algorithms. So Ada Delta, we didn't discuss, Ada Grad, Adam, over there, Adam W, which is another version. RMS prop, and so on. So all the optimizers we saw today are coded in PyTorch, and they follow the same structure. It's torch.optin.thename, like for example Adam, of the optimizer, then it takes as input the parameter, params, a learning rate, and possibly a momentum. All the optimizers have default values which correspond to the betas and so on, and you need to check in the doc if these are the values you want to use. Last thing, the params here, these are the parameters you want to optimize over, so you want to update. So it should be an iterable in Python, so like a list, for example, containing all the parameters. So if you are using a neural network, as we will see for the next course, we'll build what is called a module. And it's very easy to get the parameter. It's just the name of the module dot parameters, so this method of the module. Now, the other method which is important for optimizer is the step method. And the step method, what it's doing, it's computing the internal state that you did by hand today, according to the gradient which have been computed by PyTorch in the lost backward step. And then it updates the new parameter according to this internal state. So here, this is again the same example as we saw in the very first lecture, where we were dealing with classification. So this is NNL loss using VGG model, and here we want to update the parameter of the classifier, this with this learning rate using SGD on the training the training function is here, where you should recognize now all these steps. You take the input, you pass the input towards the model, you compute the loss, you put all the gradient to zero, loss backward will compute the gradient, and now optimizer step will compute the internal state of the optimizer and then update the parameters here according to this algorithm, SGD with this given learning rate. So that's it. So thank you and see you for the next lesson.